थैंक यू मैडम फॉर काइंड इंट्रोडक्शन एंड ऑल द काइंड वर्ड्स. सो लेट मी वेलकम यू ऑल ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ माई सेल्फ एंड ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ बेहाला कॉलेज इन दिस वेबिनार ऑन वर्चुअल लर्निंग एनवायरनमेंट व्हाट व्हाई एंड हाउ. बिफोर मेकिंग ए क्वांटम जंप इनसाइड द टॉपिक लेट मी क्लियर द टर्मिनोलॉजिकल प्लेन. For example, there are many synonymous terms we are using, possibly e-learning, digital learning environment, virtual learning environment, managed learning environment, blended learning or hybrid learning. But please remember, these are not interchangeable and these are not equivalent. First, I would like to clear the terminological plane because almost of you are basically newcomer in this domain of e-learning, and possibly we need the skills related to different aspects of e-learning in higher education very soon. We already realize this particular fact that our traditional learning environment must be supplemented and complemented by the online learning environment. So, in the online learning environment, the term e-learning we are utilizing for all kinds of thing. So, you can think that e-learning is kind of a generic term, umbrella term to indicate anything, any ICT enabled learning environment we are preparing for our students may be considered as e-learning. For example, when you are using a overhead projector, when you are using PowerPoint presentation to display in that particular overhead projector, you are circulating different kind of lecture notes amongst your student in soft copy, all comes under the purview of e-learning. You are doing some kind of e-learning there, but we need to be very careful about the terminology. So, the term e-learning came in the late 70s when we started utilizing computer and different equipments related to computer, different soft copy circulation, circulation of the course materials in CD-ROM and DVD-ROM. It all started in late 70s and early 80s. So, e-learning came that point of time. Then the moment network came, we started delivering our learning contents over the internet in an interactive manner. So, that is called digital learning environment. Meanwhile, TV as a media supplemented education. People or teachers of my age must be remembering the age old Gyan Darshan by UGC, which was actually broadcasted every day through DD national channel. So, that is also a kind of quantum jump India made during late 80s and early 90s. So, digital learning environment is delivery of the learning content over a network in an interactive mode, so that your users can interact with you or with the teachers in learning environment in all three aspects of learning, that is teaching, learning and evaluation. Then came virtual learning environment. So, when different kind of virtual communication tools, they can be divided broadly into two groups: asynchronous mode of communication like your email, or synchronous mode of communication like your real time chat services, etc. So, all this two groups of communication tools, asynchronous and synchronous both, when merged with the digital learning environment, then we termed that particular thing as a virtual learning environment. So, virtual learning environment is digital learning environment alongside or integrated with different kind of real time communication tools. Then virtual learning still actually acting as a standalone system. Now, the future concept is coming, which is called managed learning environment. Suppose in your college, you have a finance management system, you have a student management system, registration and everything. You have an examination management system. You have a library management system. So when your students' enrollment, fees collection, your library services and access, your examination subsystem, all integrated with your e-learning, so that it become a single window interface for your students, then it may be called as managed learning environment. So VLE plus all academic subsystems working in an higher education institution merge together to generate a managed learning environment. Now the next important terms is blended learning. What does it mean? When you are utilizing any of these components, e-learning, digital learning environment, virtual learning environment, or managed learning environment, alongside your traditional brick and mortar classroom based teaching, that is called blended learning or hybrid learning. So these are the terms available in the e-learning scenario or online learning scenario. You please be very careful in utilizing the terms. DLE is not equivalent to VLE. VLE is not equivalent to MLE or managed learning environment. So presently in India, we are not experimenting much with the managed learning environment. Presently, almost all the institutes, all the elite institutes, including IITs, NITs, they are all exploring different avenues related to virtual learning environment. So we selected the topic as virtual learning environment, what, why and how. But again, you know, lockdown definitely played a catalytic role to promote online learning or virtual learning environment, but that is not the only reason said that India should move towards online learning or virtual learning. So let me first give you two basic reasons why India should go for why India should make a quantum jump from traditional learning environment to digital learning environment or virtual learning environment. I will be giving you two sets of reasons. One is related with the higher education scenario of India, and second is related to a very interesting, you know, concept that is called demographic dividend or demographic bonus. So let us first discuss these two reasons as why we should leap forward towards online learning. Why, as a teacher, I need to learn apart from my subject or domain knowledge different kind of e-learning tools and techniques. Okay, so let me start this presentation with a tweet made by Sanjay Mishra, my good old friend. He started his career as a LIS teacher in Indira Gandhi National Open University and came to the interacted with the concept of e-learning there. Then he switched his role as e-learning consultant, worked for UNESCO, and presently he is working in as a director of Commonwealth of Learning and posted in Vancouver. So Sanjay, recently posted one particular thing on the eve of National Education Day of India, that is considered as November 11, is considered as the National Education Day in our country. So it's a long post. The essence I am telling you, he said that India is possibly one of the largest, educational system in the world, but we are not the finest. And e-learning may give us that, push, so that India not only remain as the largest, one of the largest educational system in the world, but it should also be considered by others as, finest, one of the finest, educational system. This is the slide. You can see I have tried here to give you a scenario kind of thing, particularly in higher education in India. So this all data is based on the latest All India Survey of Higher Education report. So it reported in India presently we have 903 number of universities, almost 40,000 college, and 10,000 institutes of national importance or deemed university. 343 universities are privately managed. 357 universities are located in rural areas. It's a good one third of our, almost more than one third of our universities are in rural setup. That's a good sign. 15 universities are exclusively meant for women, and interestingly, 4 of them are in Rajasthan, 2 in Tamil Nadu, and 1 each in Andhra Pradesh, Assam, Delhi, Haryana, Karnataka, Maharashtra, Orissa, Uttarakhand, and West Bengal. So, in the distance, you know, higher education also, you know, consists of different kind of dual mode universities or distance universities. So, we have one central open university, you all know, IGNU, New Delhi. Then we have 14 state open universities, one state private open universities, and there are 110 dual mode universities running different courses alongside the traditional courses in different parts of the country. But highest number of dual mode universities are located in Tamil Nadu, 16 in number. So if we come to the nature of these universities, there are 500 general universities like Calcutta University, Kollam University, all are general universities, 126 technical universities, 70 agricultural and allied universities, 58 medical universities, 22 law universities, 13 Sanskrit and other language universities. So, this is the picture related to universities working in India. But if we come down to the college level, as I said, only 40,000 colleges are working, almost 40,000 colleges are there in India, but college density is not the same. For example, Bangalore urban district tops in terms of the number of colleges with 893 colleges, followed by Jaipur with 508 colleges. But if you go to the different other parts of the country like Bihar and Assam and different northeastern states, the scenario is completely different. So college density, if we go by this list, that able age group, that is 18 to 23 years of age group, so it varies from 7 in Bihar to lowest in India and 51 in Karnataka, highest in India. Then all India average is 28. So per lakhs of eligible population, that is the people belonging to the age of 18 to 23 years, we have 28 colleges per lakhs of eligible population. It's a national average. Lowest in Bihar 7 and highest in Karnataka 51. So 60%, more than 60% of the colleges are located in rural areas. That's a good sign. 11%, almost 11% colleges are exclusively meant for women. 78% colleges are privately managed, again, Tamil Nadu took the highest position in case of privately aided colleges. Almost 76% of the colleges belonging to Tamil Nadu are privately managed. And next one is that almost 19%, 18.5% of the colleges are having enrollment less than 100. Very interesting fact that almost 19 to 20% colleges of India are having enrollment less than 100, and only 3.6% of colleges have enrollment more than 3,000. So bigger colleges are less in number in India, only around 4% of the total colleges. Total enrollment in higher education, we made a quantum jump there. Presently it is 36.6 million, almost equal participation from girls consist of almost 47.6% of the total enrollment. That's a good sign, but the bad sign is that gross enrollment ratio in higher education in India is only 25.8. This is not comparable with other developing countries or other developed countries like US. It is having 85.8% of enrollment. China is actually reaching, China and Brazil also, they are actually reaching 50% almost in case of gross enrollment ratio in higher education, but we are still struggling with 25.8. Male female ratio in GER is almost equivalent. Male is 26.3 and female is 24.5. Scheduled caste and scheduled tribe represent almost, you know, their proportion in the population. It is 21.8 and 15.9 respectively. Distance enrollment constitutes about 11% of the total enrollment in higher education in India. So this is the overall, you know, picture of GER and college density. Now, if we come to the progression, that how people are actually progressed from college level to university level, then to research level, again the scenario is not encouraging. If you go for the this particular data, the PhD enrollment, that is the progression up to PhD level, is less than 0.5% of the total students enrollment. So entire students who are coming inside our, you know, higher education system, only 0.5% of them are actually reaching to the top level, that is at the PhD level. Next, again interesting fact is that only 10 programs in India covers 81.2% of the total students. So students are basically going for enrollment in 10 to 11 programs, mostly arts and humanities and social sciences. So highest number of students, 36.4%, are enrolled in arts, humanities and social sciences, followed by science 17.1%, engineering and technology 14.1%, and commerce 14.1%. So at the postgraduate level, maximum students are enrolled in social science and management, comes in the number 2. And most of the PhD students are basically coming from science stream, followed by the engineering and technology. So this is the scenario of student progression, how they are progressing from undergraduate level to the PhD level. Scenario is not encouraging at all. Now if we come to the another very interesting, you know, facts and figure, that is PTR, pupil teacher ratio. In universities and colleges, it's in Indian average or national average is 30. Altogether, if you consider both colleges and universities together, but if you consider universities alone, then we are going for 1:20. So each teacher needs to manage 20, students in regular mode. It's to some extent, you know, acceptable. And most of the PhDs are produced by the state public universities. Then comes the Institute of National Importance, and followed by Central University, and then Deemed University. So again, you see there is a 80-20, rules. So 80% of your higher education, scenario is managed by state universities, but they are receiving only 20% of the budget allocation meant for universities in India. So state universities are actually bearing most of the burden of higher education. They are producing most number of PhDs, but allocation is less in compare with National Institute of National Importance, deemed universities and central universities. So resource allocation is not uniform, not according to the performance. Now if you see in the screen this particular, you know, map. So this map is developed on the basis of GER in India. You can see there are three prominent colors. So yellow color means these are actually higher GER than the national average. National average, I said 25.8, but this Delhi NCR is basically performing better than a national average. Then some of the northeastern states are doing better. So almost at par with the national average, you see entire southern states are at par with the national average of GER, that is 25.8, but the entire western India, central India and east India is actually lagging behind the national average of GER, that is they are below 25.8%. So this is again a great unevenness is actually prevailing in higher education scenario of India. Now if you compare the GER, GTER or gross total enrollment ratio of India alongside other developed and comparable countries like China and Brazil, etc. So here you see this deep yellow sign is meant for India, then red line is meant for China. You see up to 2000 almost China and India in fact we started better. Our gross enrollment ratio during 1975 to 1990 was better than China. Then up to 2000 we almost neck to neck. Then China made a quantum jump from 2001 onwards, and you see by 2019 they reached up to 43.39%, and US is having 85.8%. But if you consider this blue line, Japan is almost at 58%, and South Korea again made a quantum jump. This green line, they almost reached around 80%. So other Asian countries are doing better in case of gross enrollment ratio in higher education in compare with our country. Now what is the after effect? Now education, you see, education is basically considered as an input, and the output is measured in terms of number of research. So in an educational scenario, if you are only a consumer of knowledge, nobody is going to give you due importance. So in education, it is also checked whether you are contributor to the knowledge pool or not. So to study that particular event, that whether we are contributing or not, so what we checked, there is a database, bibliographic database called Scopus. So Scopus is basically indexed all papers in science and technology, social sciences, arts and humanities. Only the bibliographic details are available. So it searched that particular data sets called Scopus data sets produced by Elsevier, and I know this is not quite visible, let me explain. The top country during this the period 1996 to 2090, top country is United States. They produced almost 120 million papers, and India is actually in the ninth position. We produced only 16 million papers. So you see, there is no that is not comparable. US is producing 120 million papers within this almost 25 years, and we have produced only 16 million papers. Still we managed to stay in the top 10 position. Our position is ninth, but this actually reflects that as our gross enrollment ratio is less, we are producing lesser number of good research articles. Highest gross enrollment ratio available in the country US, and you see the research output of US. So why this is happening? Because of three factors. Why we are not becoming important contributor in the knowledge pool? Because we are following we are actually suffering from three factors. One is the low GT year, that is the most dramatic factor reducing the growth of India in higher education. We need to attract more talents in higher education, more number of people in higher education. And you see, finally class comes from the mass. If you do not have masses in higher education, then how can you produce classes? Then the second important factor is uneven quality. You see, in Bihar college density is 7, whether in Karnataka it is 51. Only 2-3 regions in India is higher than the national average of GTR, that is 25.8. Entire western, central and eastern India is actually below goes below down the national average of GR, and shortage of educators. So these three factors are actually complicating the growth of higher education in India. One is low GER, one is uneven quality, and one is the shortage of educators. Now this is the first set of reasons why India should go for online learning to make education really democratic, to provide access to the best of the business teachers, best of the business materials, even to the remotest learner. And once Kalam said that future of India is in the last bench of classrooms. So now we this is the time we need to act. Now after this, you know, higher education scenario in India, you got a idea. You can go through different kind of reports produced by Higher Education Institutes of India. Now let me give you the second set of reason, that is the demographic dividend. Now what is demographic dividend? According to United Nations Population Fund definition, when the economic growth potential of a country actually depends on the age structure. When working age population of a country, that is the people actually belonging to the age group of 15 to 64 is higher than the non-working age share or non-working age population, that is the children below 14 years and our senior citizens equal or higher than the age of 65. So that is called non-working population or dependent population. So when your working population is higher than your dependent population, that is called a demographic dividend or demographic bonus. Now let me give you some kind of, you know, shocking information. India entered in the era of demographic bonus or demographic dividend in the year 2018, and we are fortunate enough that from 2018 to 2055, India will enjoy a span of 37 years of this demographic dividend or demographic bonus. Our working population age will be higher than the non-working population age in during these 37 years, and this is a key factor for the future growth and development of the country. So we already entered into inside the demographic bonus. We need to take different kind of programs, different kind of system, different kind of services, facilities, utilities to train our young population, to educate our young population. Otherwise, if you fail to channelize this millions of workforce in proper educational channel, then different kind of social unrest will be occurring in future, and we will be losing the this particular demographic bonus comes within 500 or 800 years in a country. So we cannot afford to miss this bus. That is the second set of reason. Now Here I have collected this data from World Population View. So mean or median age of Indian population is 28.1. We are the youngest country in Asia, because you see in China the median age is 37.4, in Japan it is 47.3. In the entire Europe, you see in the recent pandemic, US and Europe affected mostly because their median age is higher than 40. UK it is 40.5, US almost 38.1. In Germany it is the oldest country of the Europe, 47.1, again followed by the Italy around 43.3, France 41.4. So you see, in the next 50 years, India will remain the youngest country in the world. We will have millions of workforce, and without utilizing that this particular workforce, the growth of world cannot happen. So it is our duty as an educator, as a teacher, to train this huge manpower, this huge young population, so that they become employable, they become skill oriented. Okay. Now here you see, it is not that other Asian countries have also enjoyed this demographic bonus. So in Japan, the demographic bonus started in 1964 and ended in 2004. So you see, you can realize the spectacular growth made by Japan during this period. Now Italy, the demographic bonus ended in 2002. Republic of Korea, it will be ended in 2027. Spain, it is already ended in 2014. China entered in demographic dividend era in the year 1994, and it will be ended very soon, 2031. And you see again the spectacular growth made by China during this demographic bonus period. Now in Asia, a peculiar thing happened. So China and Thailand both entered in the demographic bonus era at the same time. But for Thailand, it will be ended bit earlier because of the low population. They are having a 34 years window. Brazil also started their demographic dividend in 2006, but I will tell you the story in my next slide. And their demographic bonus will be ended in by 2038. Both India and Bangladesh entered demographic bonus era in 2018. For India, it will be ended in 2055, and for Bangladesh, it will be ended in 2052. So this is most important for both the countries, India and Bangladesh. You see, during this growth period, China made a quantum jump, but that kind of growth we have not experienced with Thailand. Same case with happened with Brazil. But I will be coming to the in the next slide related to this event. Here you see, from 60 to 2002, how our dependent age population is decreasing up to 2018. Then again it will be decreasing, and the slightly upward trend will be shown up to 2050, and when our demographic bonus will be ended, this window will be ended again, our dependent age population will be started rising. So we got a 37 years window for making our country the best of the world. But to support this particular endeavor, we need one of the finest educational system of the world. Why I am saying this? Because you see, many Asian economics like China, Japan, South Korea were able to use this demographic dividend, but that was not true for Latin America. Brazil also got this particular benefit, but their growth rate is also only twofold. But if you come to this Asian countries, China, Japan and South Korea, they actually made sevenfold increase in their GDP. But Latin American countries only made twofold, because they have not given due importance in the higher education. So United Nations also said that demographic bonus is not alone is going to work. Alongside demographic bonus, you need good health, quality education and decent employment to the entire population. So this point is actually very important for the online learning environment of India. We need to reach to the unreached through online education system, different kind of skill based educational system, different kind of job oriented educational system through online training and tutorials. Please remember that India is now producing 18% of the total world population. We are enjoying only 2.5% of the entire land of the world. But we are actually 18% of the total world population with 520 million workforce. Every year 15 million youngsters will enter in the job market. But by 2022, if we are going in this rate, in this fashion, by 2022, it was estimated that 100 million people will be unable to get jobs due to their lack of skills. So it is the high time relate the higher education scenario and this demographic bonus with e-learning. Now, what government is doing? Government recently took 7 interrelated project. One is called the NAD, towards this e-learning initiative, National Academic Depository, so that all certificates, mark sheets will be available online. So the employer can check the authenticity of that certificate, of that mark sheets online, National Academic Depository. Then comes Swayam. Swayam, you all know, as a 4-quadrant online learning platform of India. This is may be considered as MOOCs of India, massive open online courses. Then a sister project is there called Swayamprabha. So you know, bandwidth in India is quite low. High quality video dissemination became a very big problem. Say for example, even in the present bandwidth, we cannot accommodate more than 75% of live users in a webinar because of our poor bandwidth. So Swayamprabha came as a sister project of Swayam. It's a DTH, direct to home. So all the contents available in the Swayam will be directly telecasted over through DTH, direct to home, so that learners can enjoy, learner can utilize these resources. Then Project Imprint is a project, innovative projects in different kind of learning interface. Any teacher can apply projects under Imprint. So these are actually a huge amount of fund allocated for different kind of innovative projects. NIRF, you all know, this is a ranking framework, National Institutional Ranking Framework, where we are getting ranks and quotient for different universities and colleges. So that is required to identify what are the best universities, what are the best colleges in the country. ARIA is basically again a project, Atal ranking for Indian innovative assessment. So ARIA is also giving different kind of project fund for related to e-learning. Then Ministry of HRD started a portal, college portal, that is Know Your College portal. So it is a single window interface for the learner, where all college related information can be available to the learners from a single window. So these are the seven projects running by Ministry of HRD related to e-learning. But if you come down to the next facts and figure, our budget is, higher education budget is actually reducing every year, right from 2014 to 2015. So in 2014-15 it was 6.15% of the central budget, and you see in 2007-8 it actually reduced to 3.71%. Initiatives like Swayam, Swayamprabha, etc. is not alone going to solve our problem. We need higher education, more allocation for higher education. Now, if we go, latest data. So this is, you see, the red line actually indicates the total education expenditure as a percentage of the total government expenditure, and you see it is reducing constantly from 14-15 to 19-20, and 19-20 is estimated actually, so 4.14% to 3.40%. If you go by the total education expenditure as a percentage of GDP, it's the same, that we not even spending 1% of our GDP in higher education. So it's, we started in 2014-15 with 0.53%, and this is reduced to 0.45% in 19-20. So financial allocation is not at all encouraging. This is Sarva Shiksha Abhiyan. I am skipping these slides. So India's education budget even cannot fund the proposed new education policy. So you all know that government of India proposed a new educational policy, but our fund allocation is not actually quite sufficient to achieve those objectives as proposed in new education policy. Now we related this e-learning with two big factors. One is the uneven quality, low GER of Indian higher education. Then we also went through different kind of data and statistics related to demographic dividend, and possibly the solution of both the problem is online learning. So do not take online learning as only an alternative in lockdown period, because online learning came to stay with us and it will be there in future. So as a teacher, if we are not learning different skill set required for providing online learning to our students, so as a teacher it will be very difficult to survive. Only domain knowledge is not going to help teachers in higher education for survival. So as I said that e-learning scenario is basically actually there are four five equivalent terms are there. So I already explained e-learning, digital learning, virtual learning, managed learning. MOOCs is basically a kind of managed learning, but the purpose is massive, so that you can accommodate in a college, you can accommodate in a course 100, 150 students at the most. But I will be showing you, I am running a course in Swayam where there are almost 5000 plus students. We have conducted one ORPIT annual refresher course for in-service teachers in library information science. So that is normally when you are talking about UGC HRDC, the limit is 40, maximum 50. But here we taught 800 plus students in a single course. So that is massive, massive open online courses. So we are not talking about MOOCs here, we are talking about VLE here. VLE is basically related to a single institution. And MOOCs may be related to a single institution, but it is generally offered globally. Anyone can register, anyone can be a member. So virtual learning environment, first the term proposed in 2001 by Inspiral. So these are web-based toolkits to support online learning. And in the next in the coming years, Google estimated that $2 billion industry in India alone will be there for virtual learning environment by 2021. Most of this fund will be generated in the primary education, school education, different kind of competitive examinations. But higher education is actually will be enjoying almost 55% of the total fund generated by 2021, and the generation of fund is not mere figure, it's $2 billion. It is going to be $2 billion industry by 2021, so be ready for that. And it is estimated by Google. You cannot overshadow these things. Now, if we come inside the digital learning environment, you see digital learning objects are basically forming the building block of a learning environment. Digital learning objects are basically your PowerPoint slides, your lecture notes, your video tutorials, all become digital learning objects. These are repurposable. Suppose I have developed a PowerPoint slide for one of my course. You find this is useful as a supplementary content of your course, you can easily link to my content that is called LTI, Learning Tools Interoperability. A big way it is coming. So all kind of LCMS can be interacted with each other, all kind of DLOs or digital learning objects can be interlinked with each other. So future is really technologically future is really worth looking. So from this slide you just take that DLOs or digital learning objects, which are your building blocks of for forming your online educational system. This can be a PowerPoint slide, this can be a lecture note, this can be a PDF file, this can be a small video. All are actually considered as the digital learning objects, and these are the primary units of any online learning system, be it DLE, be it VLE, be it MLE, or be it MOOCs. Now you already know how to search different kind of academic resources, you see finding OER or open educational resources is becoming much more important as a teacher when you are entering inside online learning environment. So here I have given you OERs are mainly available into three groups of resources: learning object repositories, or LOR, OER search engines, and OER directories. So here I have given you a scenario. So alt YOLO lettered services like MIT OCW. So MIT is producing, or offering all of their learning content through OCW, open coursework. Anyone can download, anyone can view. Then the next important things is Marlott. It's a UK based initiatives. Lot many, you know, OER, open educational resources, are available. OERs are basically learning objects, digital learning objects, available free of cost in the public domain against a license, so that anyone can utilize those OERs inside their learning content management system. Then OpenEL courses, connections, all are actually coming in a big way. And these white lettered services are startups mainly, but we need to have a close watch of these services, but because anyone become YOLO or big services in future. Now two, three sources I would like to recommend you as a teacher. You please go through this, and if you find something good, you can download as a package, you can reutilize in your learning content management system. One important factor is OER Commons. OER Commons, you can go search, you can, you know, restrict the subject category, you can mention the educational level, right from the school education to the PG level education, all kind of, you know, resources are there as OER. You can download, so you can search here systematically, you can download and you can utilize. OER Commons is a service of worth visiting. You please visit this service before starting your online learning endeavor. Then the next tool I am going to advise is oerconsortium.org. So there are different OERs available in different countries. So OER Consortium is a single window search interface or a single repository which is accumulating all world repositories, learning repositories together. So you don't have to roam around different national repositories. You directly come to OER Consortium, and every country, every resource you can browse, you can download, you can search. So it's a, you know, again a good initiative by Open Educational Consortium. Then teachers have taken a great initiatives throughout the world. All teachers from different countries came together in a single platform, and they developed Teaching Commons. So all kind of learning objects developed, DLOs developed by OERs, developed by teachers, are actually shared through Teaching Commons. Every chance that the course you are teaching online, most of the materials will be available ready-made, and you can reutilize, you can repurpose, you can reorient these resources inside your own courses available online. So again, it's a worth visit site, teachingcommons.us. So now if you want to search, these are all kind of standalone services which are basically provide you a single window search services. But suppose if you want to search OER on a given topic, so I can recommend you some of the tools as search engines. One is Zoom, and URLs are given. I will be sharing this slide with you after this webinar is over. So all URLs are written there. You don't have to write it down. You will be having it. So OER Recommender is one of my most favorite. OER Dynamic Search Engine is also good. These are all based on Google custom search engine, but collecting OERs exclusively. Then Foxomantic and Zoom, I already told. These are the OER search engines, and these are the OER repositories available. In India, you already know IGNU developed eGANCOS. Then common our continuing educational consortium, that is called CEC, they developed one CEC LOR. So India, we started this learning object repository development long back. eGANCOS is almost now 15 years old. So there are others repositories all over the world, important repositories all over the world I have listed here, and you can have an idea. You can search Google or any of the search engine by the name, the websites will be coming, and you can go through it. Some of this I already mentioned. So as I said, that your virtual communication tools will be supported by two groups of communication inside your learning system. One is asynchronous mode of communication, another is synchronous mode of communication. So VLE is a growing and dynamic educational environment where education is changing culturally, institutionally, and technically. So I will be ending this slideshow here, and let me now go to the demonstration mode, that what tools you can utilize and what are the free web resources available, so that we can go for different kind of e-learning initiatives without spending much of the money. First, let me show what we are doing almost free of cost. So I am now going to my e-learning sites. Say we are running these three courses. One, this is meant for the fourth semester, this is meant for the second semester, and this is meant for our open course. In Kollani University, every university department needs to offer one open course, so that other departmental students can enroll. So we are offering a course there, information resource management, and that is also running online during this lockdown phase. Now if you see that what is my advice as a person who is associated with different e-learning initiatives like Swayam and Swayam Prabha and Arpit and this kind of initiatives, my suggestion is that do not try local made software solution for your e-learning initiatives. You better go for the tried and tested open source software, and we are fortunate enough we have Moodle, modular object oriented dynamic learning environment. It is based on the social constructivist theory of learning, and it's a very useful software. It's completely available as open source software. You can download, you can install inside your college server, and there are lot many plugins are there. You can produce your online classroom inside Moodle, your web conferencing inside Moodle, marksheet generation, certificate generation, all kinds of these things you can do with the help of different kind of plugins. So my suggestions with almost 10 years of experience in e-learning, that you please do not go for any tailor-made software solution, because in Moodle, in case of learning content management software, we call this kind of software as LCMS, learning content management system, because lot of open standards are coming. In future, when you will be switching to the managed learning environment, your system must support different kind of open standards. I'm going to show you how we have integrated our library services inside this e-learning initiatives. So let me first explain any of this one. So as a teacher, you can utilize Moodle Cloud. So this is available free of cost. So 50 users and 200 MB space are available to you free of cost. You can run your course for indefinite period of time. It's not limited by days, but limitation is that only 50 users you can accommodate, and only 200 MB file you can upload. And I completely agreed with you. The question popping up in your mind that number of students is very less in case of free version, only 200 MB is nothing. But I am going to show you how within this 200 MB space you can manage your video tutorial, your learning contents, your PDF file, everything. And if your requirement is slightly higher, then I'll be coming. There are different other options available inside Moodle. You can go for a primary facility, you can go for medium kind of facilities, and at the cost of $100 per annum. So $100 is equivalent to almost 7,000. 7,000 is nothing for a college nowadays. So according to your need, you can go for different kind of cloud services. If you want to test before making a decision, then you are always welcome to utilize the free versions of Moodle. That's sort of thing I am using for providing services to my second semester, fourth semester, and open course students. So suppose you see your course must be structured. So suppose if I click here in this particular course, what I did, I am running this course alone as a single teacher. This is called library service platform. So first I have given objectives of the course. So student, before starting, this is called the general section of your course. So in the general section, let me increase the slide size slightly. So in the general section, what I have given, I have given objectives of the course. Then I developed a glossary. So glossary is a list of technical terms or standard terms associated with this particular course, and this glossary is collaborative. I allow students to, or rather I give tasks them to enter definition and scope for at least 5 terms each related to this particular domain. The term list I give to them. So these are the 50 key terms related to this particular course, and each students need to take 5 different terminologies, and they need to provide the scopes, a definition and history, origin, and the further development of this course. So this is called collaborative glossary. You can utilize this. It's a very good exercise for your students. Then you can have announcement. So lot many kind of announcements, say for example when live classes is going to take place, when the next examination MCQ based evaluation is coming. So all this you can announce through this. You can have a chat service so that your students I can announce that myself will be available in the chat room from this time to that time, and my student can enter to the chat room. So if I click this chat room, you see a pop-up window will be opening. I can enter inside my chat. So presently there is no one in the chat room, but during the scheduled times, lot many students are coming for doubt clearing session. This is very helpful for doubt clearing. So I can write down something, hello, and my student can interact with this. So let me close. I'm again going to a general section. This is a very easy to operate. First you need to structure your courses. So in the general section you can give this kind of information. So this is called big blue button. So this is an online class environment I can produce inside Moodle, and this is the report, usage report. Usage report I will be coming. Moodle is not quite good to usage report generation. I am utilizing a third party analytic tool for this kind of usage report, and every week I upload this usage report. You see how this usage report is working. This is not inside Moodle we are doing. It's a 43 page report. We are utilizing another tool called Motamo. So this is the report, PDF report. I can check. Let me increase the size. So I can check how during the last week or this particular from March 24th to April 14th, how online entry happened for my students, how many visits are there, what is the number of actions they have taken, all kind of this how many students from India, how many from different other countries. So within the country, what is the location, so different student location from where they are actually accessing this so almost all over the state. Then I can have what kind of devices they have adopted. Desktop most of them are using. Then come the smartphone and tablet. Then what kind of operating system they are utilizing, what browser they have utilized, visits per local time, what is the week visits per day. So different kind of metrics I can generate, the page views, unique page views, number of downloads, how many of them actually viewed my video tutorial, all I can track. In traditional learning environment, the moment you are going beyond your classroom, you don't have any, you know, clue what your students are doing. But here every second I can track what my students are doing. So I'll be showing what tools you can utilize. Then if we come to the actual section of our unit, so this is two credit course. It includes three units. So this is the unit one. So I have given first components of this unit, so topics to be discussed in this unit. So then different topics are given. We followed the four quadrant approach of SIAM. That means every topic, say for example library ecosystem, it will be supported by e-text, it will be supported by PowerPoint slides, all will be available for downloading. Then it will be supported by a video tutorial. Then it will be supported by a list of further reading list. And finally, we can go for evaluation, MCQ based evaluation or online assignment submission, etc. So please remember, each of the topic of your unit must be supported by four quadrant. Quadrant one is your this e-text, PowerPoint slides or your 10-15 pages of lecture notes. Then it should be supported by a video tutorial. You can utilize different kind of recording equipment. For example, for this particular webinar, I am using an open source tools OBS. That is the tool is known as OBS, Open Broadcasting System. In case of this is running both for Linux and Windows. Don't think that I am utilizing Linux only. It is available inside any Linux operating system. You can utilize the same tool in Windows operating system. It's completely open source. Every bit I am showing here is open source and open standards. Now you can use CamStudio. CamStudio is a very good screen capturing software available in Windows platform. If you want to go for the screen capturing software in Linux, my suggestion is Kazam. So here you see I have given this all four quadrant available. So this is the topic, so this is the text. People can, your user can have text, then they can go for presentation, then they can go for video tutorial. Video tutorial, again I would like to advise you one thing, that do not run videos inside your Moodle, because video streaming server and learning content server is not the same thing. In a college level setup, you cannot afford to have a video streaming server. So my suggestion is that you create your video locally, either SD quality or HD quality video, then upload that video in your YouTube channel. You can prepare a YouTube channel for the college, then you embed that video inside your Moodle, so that streaming can be done from YouTube server free of cost, and inside your Moodle you are not occupying much of the space and you are not loading your server for video streaming. Video streaming is a different ball game. Let me show you. If my student click this video tutorial, what happens? So this video will be loading from YouTube. So I am utilizing less amount of space. That's why I am saying that most of the content I uploaded in different other server and embedded inside Moodle, so that I can handle everything within 200 MB of space. So this is the video tutorial I actually delivered for IGNU. It is available in the public domain. IGNU is kind enough to allow me to share with my students. It's available as OER. So you see, I am repurposing here the OER for my courses. It was meant for some other course, but I slightly tuned it and repurposed for my courses. So I can go forward, go backward.
Is cloud computing. In cloud computing, basically the library full automation process and many things. In place
but,
of the
streaming is done by YouTube. I don't have to take care of this.
Particular
so again, I am going
people
back.
People are now opting out for the cloud computing architecture.
Was.
That means
so you
the
need
entire
one of
hardware,
ecosystem?
Software, network.
Now, when your this teaching learning is done through four coordinates, or each topic you see, I have given text and video tutorial. So, second topic also, third topic also, and finally, I started evaluation. So, evaluation people can give your online assignment submission. So, these are the questions I have given. So, three assignments I have given, all of with the due dates, and they need to submit online, or either they can upload through a file. Then you see I have taken two MCQ based test. So if I click there, the MCQ will be coming. I can show you a preview. So these are the questions available. Five questions are there, MCQ based. Then I can always go to the next and other things. I can opt for this one and this way. So my students can attempt different kind of, you know, MCQ. So you have to design your course that how many assignments will be there, how many MCQ test will be there. After MCQ test, I can publish the result immediately. So suppose the result of MCQ 1, result of MCQ 2, I can allow some of the students re-attempt because of the network problem. Say let me go through the result of the MCQ 2 of unit 1. So Moodle can generate ready-made you know result. You can embed that result in PDF format inside your course and the result will be coming. So here you see in the deep level, if I increase the size for a single student, say this is the two students you can see, I hope. So what is their email address, what is their state of submission, both of them finished, when they submitted, when completed, what time they have taken. So you see this is a rank list, and the top student completed within 4 minutes 38 seconds. And second, both of them got 10 marks, but this student completed within 4 minutes, this student took 7 minutes. So ranked you can design. So what are the questions they have you know set it right. So this is 10. So let me show you another person who scored little bit up less, say 8. So this student actually answered first question full marks, all 4 question full marks, then the 5th question he or she received only 0. So in this way you can give question wise you know result alongside ready-made grade. You don't have to do anything. If you design your system in such a way, it can be done. Now when your say for example my unit 1 is completed, I can publish the grade group. Grade group means I can design the marksheet kind of thing. So I can divide that what is the weightage for online assignment 1, 2, 3, what is the weightage for the MCQ 1, 2 or so on, and I can have the final grade. You see how it looks. Again I am increasing, trying to increase the size. So this is you know the rank list. First one is student, assignment 1 she got 6, assignment 2 got 8, assignment 3 got 8, MCQ 1, MCQ 2, unit total 42, percentage is this, and letter grade is this. So all we are following the Kollani University examinations pattern, and I can publish result within 2 seconds of the examination. So that is the benefit of you know online learning environment. So in the this way the other units are also going. So let me show you that in one of our courses we have integrated this is the second semester courses, we have integrated library services inside the system. So if my students of second semester click this particular course, you see it will be slightly different than Now you see here I can have this, I can search my local Koha, that is a library automation software. Possibly your library you are using some kind of software, so you can, your student can directly search here. I can search the Union Catalog, IndCat, I can search WorldCat. So all kind of, you know, good academic resources we have, we can integrate inside module that is called LTI, Learning Tools Interoperability. For example, let me show you. I am searching web in my local catalog. So my student can click search. So inside module a pop-up window will be available and if everything is going well, if my local library server is up and running, then the data will be coming from that particular server. So first time it may take a little bit of time. So my point is that later on, this is called managed learning environment, we are going through it. So later on you can integrate many of your services, your your college repository, your college library automation, your finance management system, your examination management system inside this. So you see, it searched my local OPAC. Given that on the basis of my searching, there are how many books available? So three books are available. Now any of this book, if I click, I can see the status, how many copies are available in real time. So in real time, it is not that some kind of saved information. In real time, it can give you status from your local library automation software. So two copies are available, one copy is available for a loan, another is already under hold. So in this way I can search my local OPAC, or I can search a global union catalog. Suppose I am searching WorldCat. You see, WorldCat is the largest union catalog of the world. If I search, the search will directly go to the WorldCat and it will retrieve in real time different books available in different libraries in India and other countries on this particular search query. So you see, in the pop-up, and your student is not leaving your online learning environment or VLE. Within the VLE, they are searching, they can get your national union catalog like IndCat, your local OPAC or the global tools. So in this way we can add different other services you are subscribing in your library. Let me show you that how we are tackling different kind of learning tracking. This is called analytics. So I can utilize this Matamo service. It is again available free of cost for 21 days. So it is also very less costly, around $40 per annum. You can directly subscribe. Say for example, I want to see how my second semester students are actually, let me increase the slides slightly. Let me show you how my second semester students are actually utilizing this one. So suppose this is the area. So from April 3rd to May 1st, it's currently live, 3rd December. So up to this point of time on May 2nd, I can also select different kind of date period, starting date, end date, etc. Then I can go for generating different kind of other utilities from where people are accessing presently, who are presently live, what operating system they are using. So I can track almost every second of my learners through this kind of analytics tools, which are mainly available free of cost. I am utilizing here Matamo. It is basically generate a widget. That widget I can copy and I can paste inside my module homepage. So every time any user is interacting with any kind of resources, that widget is basically supplying information to my analytics, and I can utilize this analytics to create weekly report, monthly report, day-to-day report, everything. How many, from where they are accessing, what they are accessing, what is the number of page views, everything I can generate from here. So you see, so far today 6 visits, so 17% visits have bounced, 4.2 action per visit. What amount of time they are spending in my system, how many direct entries are there, from which states people are actually locating. I can even list cities also. So in this way you can interact or integrate your learning content management with your library management system, with different global search systems, with your analytics systems. So we are almost at the end part of this discussion. So a few sites I am going to recognize related to this Moodle. First, this Moodle.org. So this Moodle.org will allow you to download, if you want to install and run Moodle in your local servers. So please remember this site name. If you want to run Moodle in a cloud or Moodle you want to go for testing purposes, so this is the site, moodlecloud.com. So you see here free trial is actually for $0, and because of the higher demand, now onwards they are actually giving you date limit for 45 days, but long back we have registered this Moodle cloud, so that particular condition is not applied to us, so we can run this free server for indefinite period of time. But the condition is that within 30 days you need to have at least 10 visits, but normally that's not a big thing. Normally our students logged on. So this is called the starter kit. You are getting 50 user license with 200 MB space for for the lifetime. So $80 per year. $80 is almost equivalent to 5,000 rupees per year. So it's nothing for a college. So mini you can try, 100 users will be getting with 200 MB space, but do not consider the space, because you can link different kind of Dropbox, your Google cloud, different kind of cloud storage, YouTube's server to hold your learning content. Inside your Moodle you just embed those resources, so it will take only less amount of space. If you have higher need, so 200 users or 500 users, then you have to pay a little bit, $500 per year and $1,000 per year. So in India there are 3 companies which is actually Moodle certified companies. If you are not quite confident that you can run a Moodle server inside your college, you can consult this India based companies. You can search through Moodle support. 3 companies are working in India to give you support for Moodle. So this is all about Moodle cloud. Now to teachers, I want to also talk about this Moodle.net. Now in the Moodle.net, if you click this archive Moodle.net, so all kind of courses what other teachers donated will be available. You can download that course in MBZ format, and you can, that is called export, and you can import that course inside your Moodle just by giving a click, upload, import. So lot many courses like general courses like teaching English language, spoken English, basic introduction to Moodle, basic introduction to e-learning, how to utilize Moodle, basic mathematics, basic statistics, introduction to R software packages, all kind of courses are available alongside the open access books, data sets, glossary, quiz presentation, Scrum package. So Scrum package means if you install Scrum package, your Moodle is Scrum compliant. Scrum is basically an learning content export import standard. So Moodle is Scrum compliant. All these courses available there are Scrum compliant, and then you can inside your Moodle you can easily integrate, or you can upload the generic courses. You don't have to take much pain to develop different kind of general courses. So please give a look of Moodle.net. Many of the courses are available free of cost. So again I am going back to my slides, and Let me tell you as a last point that what is the difference between your traditional learning environment so far you are equipped with and the forthcoming virtual learning environment. So in virtual learning environment, learning materials and resources available within the system. In case of traditional system, resources, academic resources are available beyond the classroom. As I show you that inside module you can integrate your library, so your students don't have to go outside of the learning content management system. But in a traditional classroom, the moment class is over, you give a set of recommendation, student will go to the library and they will fetch the book. But here librarians also need to know how to integrate their different kind of services inside e-learning. If higher education is changing, then libraries also need to be changed. Then here we are going for different kind of online assessment, here examination. In online learning, it is user driven time and space. So you see, user can interact with your course materials in their suitable time, in their suitable hours. It's not a 10 to 5 classroom kind of thing. But in case of traditional learning environment, we go for institution driven time and learning. So virtual learning is actually supported by different kind of generic tools, as you saw, discussion forum, chat rooms, announcement, video conferencing, wikis, blogs, but here only classroom. So here we can go for different kind of sophisticated monitoring and tracking. Almost every second of your students you can monitor, you can check, but here we are still based on the register, tutorial records, etc. Okay, so that's all today. Best wishes to all of you. I hope that this tutorial will be coming little bit of help for you in your future endeavor for e-learning. So thank you very much. Good day. Have a nice time.